Well, it's been called the worst lie in the world. People have said, if that's God, I won't serve him. In fact, Charles Darwin claimed he slowly ceased to believe in Christianity because he could not accept that those who do not believe would be, in his words, everlasting punished. He said, and this is a damnable doctrine. Not that Charles Darwin is a great theologian by any means, but it turned him off, the doctrine of hell. Lots of people have had questions about hell. One of the most frequently asked me is hell a real place? And the answer is, of course it is. Haven't you been to Phoenix, Arizona in July? Sometimes you'll hear people say something like, that's been hell for me. I've gone through hell. Like, you know, but they're speaking figuratively. There is a real hell. The Bible supports that teaching. It's substantiated. Hell is just as real as heaven. Throughout the Gospels, you'll notice often that Jesus' teaching about hell is contrasted with his teaching about heaven. And Jesus actually spoke more about a real literal hell than anyone else in the Bible. Remember that. Jesus is the one who gives us the teaching on hell. You wouldn't really fully understand hell without Jesus teaching it. Most of the teaching in the Bible about hell comes from him. What made Jesus so eager to teach about hell? What made him so eager to labor tirelessly for the lost? It was because he knew what hell was like because Jesus created hell. He created hell, Matthew chapter 25, verse 41 says, for the devil and his angels. Jesus created hell. Knowing the truth about hell gives a person a sense of the importance of this life and eternal destiny. I want you to write that down, okay? One of the cool things about our church is people bring their Bibles, they open their Bibles, and they take notes. There was a guy from seminary who came to our church 2 weeks ago, and he snuck in on a Saturday night, and he says, I'm from seminary, and I'll be taking notes. Where could I sit? And the usher said, anywhere. And when it came time to get into the word, he realized why, because people were opening their Bibles and they were taking notes. So it's hard to remember things. And I know I've been pouring way too much in the sessions I've done. But like I said, there's so much. And even if you get a thumbnail sketch of these things, you leave and you'll look up, you'll get more. I'm thinking I'll try to get my notes maybe online so you can just study my notes. You want to do that? And so we'll get that online, and you can just read my notes. I'll have to fix them up a little better, but we'll put them on there for you. Oh, yes, you do, because that's awful. Why did I say that right now, huh? You guys are brats. That's what you are. Now I'm feeling at home. Knowing the truth about hell gives a person a sense of the importance of this life and of eternal destiny. You develop a sense of what's important. Jesus said in Matthew 16, 26, and what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your own soul? Those who are lost will not cease to exist. They will lose the reason for existence. John MacArthur, commenting on this verse, shares, the lost will not cease to exist, but will experience forever a life of uselessness, hopelessness, emptiness, and meaninglessness with no value, worth, accomplishment, purpose, goal, or hope. They will be ruined forever. They pass into a night on which no morning dawns. The Bible uses graphic terms to describe what hell will be like. Hell is described as a place of weeping and gnashing of teeth, a place of outer darkness, a place of torments, a place of everlasting destruction or ruin, a place where people are tormented with fire and brimstone, a place of maggots that don't die, a place where fire is not quenched, a furnace of fire, a place where there's no rest, a place that will ultimately be a lake of fire, a place of hopelessly and unsatisfied desires like unquenchable thirst, a place of separation, a place filled with the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, murderers, sexual perverts, an immoral person who practice magic arts, idolaters, and all liars, a place filled with demons and fallen angels. I want you to note, don't shoot the messenger. Jesus said most of this. Jesus said most of this. This is what it would be like to be away from the Lord. It means being away from every good thing and every safe thing. Now, I want you to look, would you, to Revelation chapter 20. Revelation chapter 20. Just before the story ends, Revelation chapter 20, verse 7. When the 1,000 years are completed, Satan will be released from his prison and will come out to deceive the nations, which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together for the war. The number of them is like the sand of the seashore. And they came up on the broad plain of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city, and fire came down from heaven and devoured them. Like you're going to attack God, you know, his dwelling on earth, the Jerusalem during the millennium. God's saying, I don't think so. And the devil who deceived them was thrown into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are also, and they will be tormented, how long? Day and night, forever and ever. I really would like you to say, day and night, forever and ever. Now, this is important. Read on, verse 11. Then I saw a great white throne, and him who sat upon it, from whose presence earth and heaven fled away. And no place was found for them. And I saw the dead, the great and the small, standing before the throne, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged from the things which were written in the books according to their deeds. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead which were in them, and they were judged, every one of them according to their deeds. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. And if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. People have questions about the duration of hell. Groups like Seventh-day Adventists and Jehovah's Witnesses insist that hell is not eternal. They say that it ends with the total annihilation of the wicked. And, you know, I don't know how long that takes. Maybe a Hitler burns for 100,000 years. But then eventually the fire goes out and there's the smoke and it's done. Teaching like this strikes a chord in many people's hearts because people are compassionate and people hate to think of somebody else hurting. And we might put ourselves in somebody else's place. Lots of people contact me and they share that they just can't believe in a hell that involves eternal punishment. And it's a question that does come up repeatedly. And and I think, bless their hearts, most people, it's simply because of the love of God and wanting to reflect our kind of love and maybe misunderstanding sense of justice that we ought to have as well. How long will hell last? Well, let's let Jesus speak. Look at Matthew chapter 25. Let's let our Lord talk about it. We'll let the Bible do the speaking. We need to understand that we read the Bible and we let it say what it says. The Bible says what it means. We don't have to take the Bible and convolute it in any way. Usually, I would say almost always, the simple meaning of the text is what the text means. Unless the Bible says that something is a sign, or it says this is a picture of something, then we just believe it and take it literally. And when we read the Old Testament, we always want to take it in the light of the New Covenant, or else you'll come up with doctrinal mistakes, like Adventism, for instance. And then when we're looking at the New Testament, we want to make sure that we look at the Gospels in the light of the teaching of our apostles. And we want to make sure that we're interpreting properly the instructions of the gospel even. So there's this interpretation you just want to do. Don't read in. Just let the Bible say what it says. Okay, Matthew 25, verse 31. But when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on his glorious throne. Now, this is the second coming. We call it the glorious appearing. This is not the rapture, but this is the second phase of the Lord's return, right? We talked about that. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate them from one another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats, and he will put the sheep on his right and the goats on the left. Verse 41. Then he will also say to those on his left, depart from me, accursed ones, into the what fire? Eternal fire, which has been prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, you didn't invite me in. Naked, you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison, you didn't visit me. Then they answered, and they will say, Lord, when did all this happen? You know, when? Tell us when. And then Jesus tells them in verse 45, truly I say to you, to the extent that you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. Verse 46, important passage. These will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into what? Eternal life. Now tell me, one side is eternal punishment, okay? The other side is eternal life. They're balanced. We know eternal life generally means a life that never what? Ends. So if we're saying eternal life on one side and then we say eternal punishment on the other side, wouldn't you think that eternal punishment is the same? It's forever.
Is it the same Greek word?
Yes. Stop jumping ahead. Yes, it is. I've got to mess with you because you're pickable, right? I can pick on you. Eternal punishment is not something that somebody made up. It's a reality. Jesus indicates that it will be eternal. It will last forever. The New Testament speaks about hell 162 times. Did you know that? And it's teaching about hell. It indicates that hell is eternal punishment in almost all of those times. Now, some people try to reason that eternal hell is not eternal hell, but just how long is eternal? The same Greek word that describes the duration of hell, eternal hell that we're just reading, is aionios, okay? Is the same word that is used to say eternal life, aionios. So you've got the same Greek word. So say, same Greek word. Eternal and eternal. Well, that would kind of close the deal for me, but it doesn't for some people. The same word eternal is used to describe God himself. God is eternal. He's everlasting. How long is God's glory going to last? For all eternity. It's forever. So the duration of the punishment of the wicked is the same as God's eternal life. It's forever and ever. In Genesis 21, verse 33, Abraham planted a tree in Beersheba, and he called on the name of the Lord, the everlasting God. Psalm 90, verse 1 and 2 says, Lord, you've been our dwelling place through all generations. Before the mountains were born, you gave birth to the earth and the world, and from everlasting to what? Everlasting, you are God. So eternal the same concept of eternal God, the nature of God, is used to speak of the eternal nature and duration of hell. Revelation chapter 4 records a scene of worship in heaven. Let's look at it. Revelation chapter 4. Verses 9 and 10. This is after the rapture, by the way. Remember the promise to the church in Philadelphia that he says, I'm the one who I open and no man can shut, and I shut, no one can open. And he says, I have set before you an open door. And he says, I will keep you from the hour of testing, the hour which is about to come upon the whole earth to test those who dwell in the earth. You remember that? I'll take you out. I'll keep you out. Tereo ek. Remember? Now, the open door, he says, I'll set before you an open door. Guess what the open door is? Chapter 4, verse 1. After these things, I looked, and behold, a what? Door was open in heaven. The last thing you read about the church on earth is the end of Revelation 3. The next thing you read in chapter 4 is an open door that the church has gone through at the rapture, and you see the church worshiping in heaven. Now, during that worship service, look at verses 9 and 10. And when the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who sits on the throne, to him who lives how long? Forever and ever. The 24 elders will sit down and they'll fall before him, and they will cast their crowns before him. And it says, they worship the one who lives forever and ever. And then they say that doxology, you know, worthy are you, O Lord. So the worship of God is worshiping the God who exists forever and ever. That's, now you know the chorus that you'll be singing in heaven. Worthy is the Lamb, we worship you, Lord, for you shall reign and you live for how long, gang? Forever and ever. Now in Revelation 5, verse 13, this is where I meant to go. And every created thing which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth and on the sea and all things in them I heard saying, to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and dominion, go ahead, forever and ever. I want you to understand, when is the worship of God going to end?
Never.
It's forever and ever. It's the same word that's used to speak of eternal hell. So when would hell end?
Never.
It's the same word. We have to understand. We can't be selective. In Revelation 1, verses 17 and 18, the word eternal or everlasting is also used to describe the resurrection life of Christ himself. Revelation 1, 17 and 18. Revelation 1, 17. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as a dead man, and he laid his right hand upon me, saying, don't be afraid. I'm the first and the last and the living one, and I was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and of Hades. He's got the master key. Okay, so how long is the Lord going to live? Forever and ever. I mean, he's eternally existing. But in his resurrection, in his life, and he speaks to John and says, I'm the living one. My life is forever. The word eternal or everlasting is used to describe the length of Jesus' reign. Revelation 11 talks about the length of his reign. I don't mean to be redundant, but I think these are important places to take people who are kind of choking on the concept of an eternal hell. We have to nail down the usage of this word eternal. It means forever in every context. And so here we have Revelation 11, verse 15. Revelation chapter 11. Verse 15, and the seventh angel sounded, and there arose loud voices in heaven saying, and I wish I could do a loud voice that would sound cool. The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he will reign, help me out, forever and ever. The same word is used to describe the length of the reign of God's saints. Look just right there, Revelation chapter 22. The length of your reign with Christ, Revelation chapter 22, verse 5. And there will no longer be any night, and they will not have need of the lamp, light of a lamp, nor the light of the sun, because the Lord God will illumine them, and they will reign forever and ever. Now, 10 times, you can write it down, 10 times, the New Testament uses the same word to ascribe glory to God. The word aionios, everlasting, eternal, forever. I'm not going to belabor it, but again, the wealth of scripture truth needs to be laid out. It's almost like a tidal wave of truth. It's a huge wave. Listen, the word eternal, the same word for everlasting hell, eternal hell. Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. 2 Timothy, to him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Galatians, to whom be the glory forever. Amen. Hebrews, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Peter, to whom belongs the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Peter again, to him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen. Revelation 1, to him be the glory and the dominion forever and ever. Amen. Revelation 5, to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and dominion forever and ever. Saying blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be unto our God forever and ever. Okay, these are just the doxologies in the scripture. And we understand now, driven into our brains, that forever means forever because it describes the nature, the attributes, the reign, the glory, the worship of God. But this very same word is used referring to the torment of the wicked. Revelation chapter 14, look at 14, verse 11. Revelation 14, verse 11. In the smoke of their torment goes up forever and ever. They have no rest. Day and night, those who worship the beast and his image, and whoever receives the mark of his name. They have no rest. How long? Forever and ever. Those who have worshiped the beast during the tribulation, they have not followed the Lord. They are lost, and they, like every wicked person, will end up suffering eternally in hell. Revelation chapter 20 declares again, the fate of the wicked and the eternality of hell. Revelation chapter 20, verse 10. And the devil who deceived them was thrown into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are also. By the way, they are right now, he says, they are in this lake of fire. When did they get into the lake of fire? If you go to Revelation chapter 19, it was at the end of chapter 19, they were thrown into the lake of fire. Satan was chained. The millennium began on earth. And now at the end of the millennium, Satan is released and he will be now cast into the lake of fire where the beast and the false prophet are. They've been there for 1,000 years and they're still there. I wouldn't want to be them, that's for sure. And they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. And I have to say, yay, God. Do you believe the beast? Well, you don't know the beast or the Antichrist, thankfully. But Satan and all his minions, they deserve to be punished forever and ever and ever. Do you agree with me? Or do you have sympathy for him? I have no sympathy for Satan. May he, well, I'll be respectful. We're not supposed to rail against him. But if anybody deserves it, hell was prepared for him and for his angels. Look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. You know your Bibles, and it's so fun to go over territory quickly. It's really cool to see you guys flying through the scriptures. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 8 and 9. It says that the Lord Jesus will be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire. That is called the glorious appearing, right? That's the second phase of Jesus' second coming. The Lord Jesus will be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, dealing out retribution to those who do not know God and those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. Okay, I do want to pause here. What is obeying the gospel? Exactly. It's not health, you know. I remember I was talking to a friend. He lives in Phoenix. He's an Adventist pastor. I said, well, you know, but it's the gospel. And he says, well, I don't define the gospel as narrowly as you do. And I said, well, 1 Corinthians 15, the gospel that you believe that saved you, that you trust and you stand, that Christ died, he was buried, he rose again, right? That's Paul's apostolic definition of the gospel. I mean, I can't improve on it. I can't add or subtract from it. Well, he says, I don't define it that narrowly. And I was like, almost drop my fork. I said, well, what is the gospel? He says, well, I think it's health. I think it's the second coming. Not for you. I mean, it's, you don't have the hope of the rapture even, you know. And there's, you know, all these little other things where the gospel. No, the gospel that needs to be obeyed is not to become a vegetarian. It's not to keep a Sabbath day. It is not to anything. It's to believe, okay? And you were right. You were right. To believe is the work. That is obedience. It's called the obedience of faith. Okay. But God is going to deal out retribution to those who do not know him, to those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. Verse 9, these will pay the penalty of eternal destruction away from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. Aha, there you have it. It's not eternal, everlasting, Mark. It's destruction. I'm glad you brought that up. Because it means ruin. It means ruin. They are everlastingly ruined. Remember the quote I read earlier about how their life is ruined. It's eternal ruination. They will never, ever, ever, ever be a together person. They will be in everlasting hell. You have to interpret a text, one text like this, in the light of the majority of what God says. This is not a scripture that is contradicts the scripture at all. Now, with this in mind, remember Jesus' words in Matthew 25. So we're going to buzz back to Matthew chapter 25. Can you think while you're going there? Can I talk while you're looking? Okay. That last passage we read was an encouragement to the believers in Thessalonica who were under persecution. Paul says, you guys are being persecuted right now severely. Some of them were dying. He says, I just want you to be encouraged that the Lord Jesus is going to come back. He's going to come with his fire, and flaming fires with his holy angels, and he's going to deal out retribution to those who don't obey the gospel. And he's going to judge these people that are hurting you. Wow. What do you think I'd get if I preached a sermon like that? But you have to understand, that's some of the comfort of the saints. Is to know. I mean, I didn't make it up. Paul is writing it. That's why you always want to read the whole paragraph, right? But in that whole paragraph, he's saying, don't worry. Judgment day is coming and they're going to get what they deserve. Sounds mean? I don't know. I've seen too many cases. You know, I've been a pastor almost 30 years. Longer than that, actually. Over 30 years. Way over. And I have seen things where rotten people People who have done perverse, wicked, hateful things have gotten off scot-free, and it irks me. But the doctrine of hell, I don't mean to sound cruel, but I understand that God has perfect wrath toward that kind of sin. I might be mean-spirited in my wrath. I would have a corrupted anger. God's anger is perfect. His wrath is perfect and just. There is no unjustness in his anger, in his wrath, in his hate. We always talk about, you know, the love of God, but you have to understand that God isn't compartmentalized. Like, here's the love box, here's the justice part, here's the compassion part. No, God is all of that all of the time, right? His grace, we've discovered, is so immense, but so are all his other attributes. They are all just as immense as his grace. So as we are now in Matthew 25, verses 41 and 46, Jesus will say to those on his left, just remember, depart from me, accursed ones, into the eternal fire, prepared for the devil and the angels. These will, verse 46, go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. Now, another question that comes up is, well, how can spiritually dead people experience torment? Does the term eternal death appear in the Bible? No, the term eternal death does not appear in the Bible, but the term second death does. A second death. And that will be speaking of people who will experience eternal hell. They will have an eternal life in hell. I know we're hopping back and forth, but would we go back, please, to Revelation chapter 20? I could ask you to keep markers in these places, but you would get hopelessly tied up with markers, right? Revelation 20, verse 6. There's a first resurrection. You want to be part of that. But those who are part of the second resurrection, this speaks of eternal lostness, of eternal death. And what does the word death mean again? Tell me.
Separation.
Separation, exactly. Thanatos means to separate. It never means unconsciousness. So we go to verse 6. It says, blessed and holy is the one who has a part in the first resurrection. Over these, the second death has no power. I want to address an issue now of that is a big Adventist question. Graham Maxwell, who was a well-known Adventist preacher, struck a chord in the hearts of thousands and thousands of Adventists across the English-speaking world, at least. He wanted to explain a God of love, and in his attempt to do that, he asked the question, can God be trusted? Do you remember hearing him say that?
Yes.
In fact, didn't he have a book?
Yes.
Can God be trusted? I scratch my head now and think, blasphemy, absolutely, like pipsqueak earthlings, you know, created beings. How could you even say such a thing? Can God be trusted? And he built a theology, and he built almost a subculture in Adventism. Can God be trusted? You know, how could a good God send people to an eternal hell? Could a God like that be trusted? Could a God who would judge people for something they did in time and would judge them for all eternity through it, how could a God like that be trusted? Well, the answer is another question, and the question is, how could a God of love not uphold justice and punish evil? If God is a God of love, then he's got to be a God of justice and judgment as well. I mean, if you have somebody do something that hurts you, perhaps one of your children is molested, or somebody has murdered a spouse, or there's just an intense crime that's taken place, and you go to the judge, and the judge is concerned that people won't trust him if he passes a just verdict, and so he lets you go because, I mean, he lets the murderer go because, you know, he wants people to think he could be trusted. Is that a just judge? No. A just judge has to do the right thing, and the right thing, a God of love would always do the right thing, correct? Love always does the right thing. The right thing is judgment to those who deserve it. Outside, and this is the miracle of the gospel, that we are spared. You know, God has satisfied his own judgment in the sacrifice of his son, in this whole glorious plan of the gospel of grace and salvation. Why such a drastic penalty? Why eternal hell? The enormity of hell suggests the enormity of the offense. God is perfectly just. I'm sorry, Mr. Maxwell. God is just. Maybe you've discovered that now. I don't know. But God is completely just and righteous. The enormity of the offense against God then must be so heinous that God, the penalty has to be this. He would not do anything unjust. Hell is not unjust. We just don't have an appreciation for God's holiness. God isn't the man in the sky. He's not I've met these guys that say, yeah, you know, the man in the sky or the big man in heaven. I'm like, oh, Lord, he doesn't know what he's saying right now. He doesn't understand and appreciate your holiness and your glory. Habakkuk, he says in chapter 1:13, your eyes are too pure to look on evil. You cannot tolerate wrong. The Bible says all God's acts are just and true. God takes no pleasure in wickedness. And so if we deconstruct God enough, then we can say hell isn't eternal. You know, okay, so, you know, I messed up, so burn me up. And there's no reason to really get my act together and listen to the message that we must flee the wrath of God. However, if we blow up the image of God and we see, hey, this is the grand God we serve, the eternal one, who in grace has condescended to show himself to us and given a revelation of himself to us, naturally, through supernatural means, through the incarnation of Jesus Christ, then he is the Holy One and he deserves to be worshiped with awe and fear and reverence. This is part, you know, of the Lord that, you know, we just don't think about enough. The enormity of the sentence is based on the enormity of the crime. God is just. Hell proves, and I think this is finally, which means the pastor has, another 20 minutes to go, but truly I think this is finally here. What does hell prove? Hell proves that evil does not pay, or actually there is a payment for evil. Without the reality of hell, many things do not make sense. We know that in society, the punishment of evil shows that good has prevailed. If there's no punishment of sin and it's eternal affront to God, then there is no such thing as good prevailing. Ultimately, God's eternal goodness and victory over evil is shown in the eternal punishment of sin. Justice makes no sense without the reality of eternal hell. Because ultimately, our sense of justice is backed up by the understanding that God is perfectly just and will someday punish all sin and wrongdoing. Jesus experienced hell because he's eternal in his nature, Perfect God, perfect man, came with a perfect nature. His perfect humanity always submitted to the Father. His perfect deity never stopped being God, this mystery of godliness. Jesus, therefore, was able in his eternality to experience eternal hell for us. As I see, he didn't experience hell and punishment that was simply a punishment that ended. He experienced the eternal, 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 eternal consequences of sin. And we are saved from sin. We are saved from eternal hell because of what Jesus Christ has done for us. Now listen, if hell is this real, then it is incumbent upon us to share the gospel message. People have to know. I mean, if we really believe this, now what are we going to do about it? Share the word, invest in the word, get involved in a church, share the gospel with people around you. Don't give up on that stubborn person. Hang in there. God is just. God can be trusted. God is going to make all things right in the end, in his perfect, majestic way. Let's pray. Lord, you are the eternal one, and we bow before you, and we thank you that all your ways are just. We thank you that there is a perfect standard and there is perfect justice. We thank you in awe of what the scripture says about the lostness of hell. We stand in awe of that. We look at it and we almost gasp. And then we look at the cross. And we see and understand the cross in a greater way than we ever have before. Thank you for saving us. Thank you, Lord, for delivering us from hell. And we pray that the gospel will go forward around the world, in this city, in our cities and towns, that there would be millions saved from this sure fate apart from Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.